Councilmember Brooks?
Present.
Councilmember Collins?
Here.
Councilmember Gates?
Here.
Councilmember Kidd?
Here.
Councilmember Whedon?
Here.
Manager Keane?
Here.
Attorney Warren?
Here.
Okay, thank you. Please rise for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Carry you on the microphone. Got one down there.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Mr. Robinson to come down, please. Shortly after the massacre in Chattanooga, Tennessee, I got an email from Leslie asking if the city was going to do anything to recognize the loss of that community. She suggested that we could possibly put together a banner, and I really liked that idea. So I talked to the city manager about it, and we organized what we thought was going to be just one banner that took on a life of its own. So, and it was all due to your suggestion and your work and help and the revitalized PA folks for getting behind this effort. And after reading your messages on Facebook, it looks like the community there was very touched with the outpouring of sympathy from the community of Fort Angeles. And so because of that, I'd like to present you with a small token of our appreciation. I'd like to present you with these flowers.
Oh.
This is on behalf of the city council and the city. There you go.
Thank you so much. I just want to say that it was an honor, and I am so humbled to have been chosen to be the representative for Port Angeles. And it was so obvious when I was there that this gesture was so much more than a gesture to the people of Chattanooga. They were moved. They were clearly moved. Every person I spoke to was just touched beyond words that we had not only filled up so many banners, but that had personally delivered them to the city of Chattanooga and to the servicemen who had lost their lives. So it was an experience I will never forget. And I hope that we have forged a special connection with them beyond the outside magazine contest. And now it's almost like we're sister cities, and I hope that we can maintain that connection again. And again, I want to thank the city for allowing me to have this wonderful experience. And I know that we will be getting some Chattanoogans to visit Fort Angeles very soon. Thank you.
I called the mayor of Chattanooga to let him know that we were sending a representative out there. He was surprised that we would go to that effort. I think they were aware that at that time that we were doing a banner, but they weren't. I didn't think they anticipated us and somebody would personally deliver those. So again, thank you very much. This public comment period of time, we have a huge number of people signed up this evening, so I would ask that you keep your remarks 3 minutes, please. And the first person is Deborah Zabach. Have the microphone, give your name and address, please. Yes, the one on your right.
My name is Deborah Bopp. My address is 2430 Monroe, Fort Angeles. I am a certified nurse midwife with 32 years experience, and for the past 16 years I've been in practice here in Fort Angeles delivering babies at our local hospital. As a midwife, my training and philosophical approach is to view pregnancy and birth as normal events that should receive support and education. Intervening in natural processes should be reserved for situations where it is clearly needed and safe. Fluoridation of the public water supply is one such area. Before I moved here, I delivered babies in downtown Washington, D.C., Baltimore, and rural Virginia, areas with poverty and poor access to dental care. But within weeks of arriving here, I was struck by how many of my patients who were otherwise healthy young women had simply awful teeth. A few months later, I took my own two-year-old to the pediatrician and then became aware that the fluoride in the water that I had taken for granted was not present here. He gave me a prescription for fluoride for her, which Jim's billed for about a penny, as I recall. Even as a parent who understood the importance of fluoride and dental hygiene for her teeth, it was hard to remember to give it to her daily and instill good dental hygiene practices. The fluoride in water that washes over teeth as they are rubbed is very important, and it will take several years before the childhood effects will be fully visible in the age group of women I most often see. But I do think things are improving a bit since 2006, when fluoride was first added to the water. There seems to be a lot of needless fear about this topic, and it generates strong emotions for many people. But as someone who delivers our littlest citizens of Port Angeles, I urge the City Council to support continued fluoridation of our water and to use good judgment in the wording of the advisory poll that you will be conducting on this important issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Toby Cook?
Yes.
Excuse me, I'm going to divert from the fluoride debate for a moment. Tony Cook, 673 Seal Rock Road, Port Angeles, Washington. And I'm the draftee who thinks the draftee should have a plaque in the Veterans Park in Port Angeles, Washington. I'm a little mystified that we don't. I don't understand the logic why a veteran is not included in a Veterans Park. I don't get it. And I would also like to thank three members of the council for speaking with me one-on-one. One member, we spent 2 hours together and we solved almost every problem in the world. We even visited the Veterans Park. It was a good time. But nothing's happening. And no one responds to my letters. No one can explain to me why. I always thought I was a military veteran. I spent combat tour in Vietnam. I served 1 year, 9 months, and 4 days active duty. I always thought I was a veteran until I tried to put plaques in a veterans park honoring veterans, and I'm told, no, you can't do that. It makes absolutely no sense. The fact that anyone had to ask about it, to be vetted as a veteran makes no sense. I was discharged honorably. I received my discharge papers about 4 years later. It's just silly. So I won't spend a lot of time. All of you know the issue, but there's two things that I've noticed that I don't think any of you have seen. In the park, there are at least two memorials honoring World War II merchant marines, which were very honorable men. They did a great job, but they weren't veterans. They were actually private contractors. And they didn't receive veteran status until 1988 because of a lawsuit. And they're in a veterans park, and they're just anointed veterans. They're not real veterans. But you won't let draftees have plaques in the park. I don't understand it. Another issue. I have an uncle who was off the coast of Japan in 1945 when we dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And I assure you, he had some very bad feelings toward the Japanese because some of his fellow sailors were killed by the Japanese Navy and Japanese aircraft. And in the hallway of this building, you had a memorial to a country that attacked our country on December 7, 1941, Japan. And I understand why that memorial is there. This is the 21st century. I understand that. But there are some World War II veterans who would be highly offended that you honor a country that attacked our country on December 7, 1941. I don't feel that way, but they would. And no one seems to care about that. So if you can honor private contractors in a veterans park who aren't really veterans, they were made veterans in 1988 because of a lawsuit, and you can memorialize a country that attacked our country in 1941 and killed about 2,000 of our military people and subsequently killed tens of thousands of our people, including draftees, in the war. Why can't you let draftees have plaques in the park? Thank you very much. Okay. Mr. Grant?
I'm Patricia Graham of 1503 East 3rd Street, Port Angeles.
First off, I'm a little bewildered that after 10 years of fluoridation, you guys are asking for more information. I thought we pretty much bombarded you with a whole bunch of information. But anyhow, I wanted to point out a few things that at the last meeting was out. What is a mineral? Well, I looked it up in the Webster's Dictionary, and a mineral is any class of substance occurring in nature, usually comprising inorganic substance as quartz or feldspar, or definite chemical composition and usually of definite crystal structure, but sometimes also including rocks. And I will go on that. And then what is a chemical? Any substance used in or resulting from a reaction involving changes to atoms or molecules, especially one derived artificially for practical uses. So I have concluded that fluorosilicic acid is a compound chemical, not a mineral. And the newspaper keeps printing that it's a mineral. This is misleading to the public. I am very aware of the dental community saying this is a mineral. And I do respect all the dentists here, and I appreciate all the service that they provide to the community. But I disagree with them. Now, if you were to list the element fluoride, they provide, wait a minute, where am I at? Now, if you were to list the element fluoride on the periodic table, do you all know what the periodic table is? It would be F. Fluorosilicic acid is H2F6SI. As I read in the definition of a chemical, fluorosilicic acid was produced from a production of phosphoric acid and from apatite and furopatite. So therefore, it is a compound chemical. It's not a mineral. I have an MDS printed up for all of you, and I hope you take the time. I won't go over all of it because it's pretty long, but it's safety and everything about fluorosilicic acid. So I'd like to present you with each one of these and have you go over it. Please, please do read it because it's very important.
Hey, next will be Rick Marshall.
Hi, my name is Dr. Rick Marshall. I'm an naturopathic physician residing at 162 South Bar Road in Port Angeles. And I know this isn't the actual hearing around fluoride, but I did want to say some things. And when we have the hearing, I'm going to go ahead and bring in some Harvard papers and some UC papers that have come about recently in the last 10 years. And I guess that's partly why this council is interested in what's happening around the fluoride, because almost 10 years have transpired, and we now know things that we didn't know 10 years ago. What Harvard is saying and what other universities are saying is that the amount of fluoride in the environment from pesticides and from fluoridation has accumulated. And now there is so much around that different conditions are coming up. The Harvard study shows cognitive disorder in children. Now, how is this to be? Well, it has to do with not what people say and want you to believe, but actual scientific evidence that you'll see in these papers. For example, the natural occurring fluoride, the mineral that the previous speaker was just talking about, is in the water, in most water supplies, at about 2 milligrams per liter. Now, that's the EPA limit for children. They don't want to see it go any higher than 2 milligrams per liter. And that's what occurs naturally in the water supply. Even if your water supply has a little bit less, if you add up the amount that's in coming into the water from pesticides that isn't necessarily measured, or the amount that dentists are using when they apply treatments to the teeth, then basically adding more fluoride as a chemical, which is more toxic than just the fluoride mineral, to the water supply is medicating the public. Now, if you think it's okay to medicate the public, maybe, you know, to control birth control, to have birth control, we ought to start adding spermicides in the water. And I can think of a dozen other things you might think we should do to medicate the water, because we got a lot of depression. Maybe we should put Prozac in the water. I don't think so. I don't think you should be involved in medicating our water, my patient's water, at all. That's outside your jurisdiction. You should stick to the things you're good at. So that's really all I have to say for now.
Is it Gary or Gray or is it Koyak?
So I'll keep it short this evening. My name is Greg Koyak. I'm a practicing dentist from Port Angeles. The 2007 Hamilton Way. As far as the fluoridation debate goes, one thing that that we'd like to talk about in the medical realm is medical models. And in the current medical models that we look at are based primarily on prevention. And fluoride is one of the largest and most efficacious aspects that we've used in dentistry in controlling dental decay. And it's something that certainly is a part of what we do on a regular basis. We also, I know that this was brought up previously, we use nutritional counseling. We talk to patients every day about nutrition. We also talk about brushing and flossing properly. And the last thing we talk about is fluoride. It's an important thing in everything we do in topical type of applications, but also in the water supply. There's a very large portion of the population that does not see a dentist on a regular basis. And this is the only way that we're able to get it to, especially primarily the children. It does help also in senior citizens significantly, and in adults. I see patients every day that have grown up outside of Port Angeles in fluoridated areas. I'm one of them. I grew up in a fluoridated area. I've got one cavity in my mouth, and that's my own fault. Most of the patients that I've seen that have grown up in fluoridated areas do not have decay, and this is something I see every day. Patients that haven't grown up in fluoridated areas, we see a lot of decay, you know, either that have been filled or, you know, areas that need to be filled. So, and it causes a lot of pain and suffering in these patients. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.
Scott and Megan.
Scott Van Dyken. I have a dental practice here in Port Angeles, Washington, at 606 East 8th Street. Thank you again for taking the time to listen to me once more. You have a very important job in taking care of this community. And I spoke last time about children and how the enamel's harder. And it was pointed out to me after the meeting that I never did speak to what my position was in terms of fluoridating the water. And where I'm at is, I did not speak to it kind of on purpose last time because I'm going to use the word I'm not sure. How do you like that? And beyond that is I've taken some time. I have 7 children. I have a very busy dental practice, but I've taken some time to do some reading. Some of the arguments you're hearing that come from both sides of this argument are quick reads on the internet. And what I would say to that is this. We all need to be resident. We all need to think, actually, you all is you all, about where you're getting your information from. I don't want it to come from me on this topic. It needs to come from somebody that's done the studies. And I take a step back. I hear about Harvard. Somebody needs to go read that article and make up their own mind on that. I can tell you what to think on that. I think you need to talk to your federal government, your CDC, and you need to kind of look at people that are held responsible for a larger body of people in this country and what's happening with those decisions. And I will be content with whatever you decide, but I will also want us to make make sure that you think of the children in this community. I know there's a defined benefit for them. The other side of this argument, I spoke into that already. Thank you for your time.
Tom Anderson. I live at 324 North Lees Creek Road. I'm not a dentist. I'm a patient. I am here not so much to speak against fluoride as much as I am here to question the process that eventually forced the people of Port Angeles to turn their water supply into toxic waste dump. I spent some time reviewing the memorandum of understanding that the mayor of Port Angeles signed on May 20th, 2003. In this memorandum was what I would define as a disclaimer, which should have set off all sorts of alarms, but was oddly disregarded in favor of signing the thing and moving the process of fluoridating the city water supply forward. Item 11 of the memorandum said, and I quote, "Under the gift agreement, the city will agree that Washington Dental Service Foundation will not be liable for any special, indirect, or consequential damages in connection with the gift of the system or otherwise arising out of the gift agreement, even if WDSF has been advised of the possibility of such damages." When I read that, I had to ask myself, why would anyone sign an agreement which included such a blatant admission, almost, of culpability? And why would they do it on behalf of the city's entire population? I wouldn't have signed it if I had only myself to consider. To me, this disregard for the possible ramifications of what he was about to do never seemed to have entered the mayor's mind. This apparent disregard for the public safety by the city's highest elected official, I believe, can be rectified. I feel that this council has been given the opportunity to right a great wrong. I sincerely hope the council realizes this and will act accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Rose Marshall. I live at 162 South Bar Road, Port Angeles. I think I came here and I did do a quick study on the internet. And you can find some good things on the internet. You know, there's bad things too. But I think this might be the report that Rick Marshall, my husband, referred to. And it, I'm going to read what I got out of that. So the Lancet Neurology Journal reclassifies fluoride as a developmental neurotoxin. I don't know why you guys think it's okay for you to put developmental neurotoxins by a Harvard School of Public Health and the Icahn School of Medicine in the citizens' water. And I do believe it's forced medication. You gotta really look at that. Somebody should do a class action lawsuit. But anyway, that's beyond the point. Somebody will someday. Anyway, this is what it says. A meta-analysis of 27 cross-sectional studies of children exposed to fluoride in drinking water, mainly from China, suggests an average IQ decrease of about 7 points in children. The majority of these children had water fluoride levels of less than 4 milligrams per liter, which falls under the allowable level set by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, so it's higher. Fluoride seems to be fit in with lead, mercury, and other poisons that cause chemical brain drain, Dr. Grandjean says. The effect of each toxicant may seem small, but the combined damage on a population scale can be serious, especially because the brain power of the next generation is crucial to all of us. Neurodevelopment disabilities include autism, hyperactivity disorder, dyslexia, and other cognitive impairments, affect millions of children worldwide, and some diagnoses seem to be increasing in frequency. Industrial chemicals that injure the developing brain are among known causes for this rise in prevalence. In 2006, we did a systematic review, identified 5 industrial chemicals as developmental neurotoxicants: lead, methyl, mercury, common in vaccines, polychlorinated biphenyls, arsenic, and toluene, whatever. Since 2006, epidemiological studies have documented 6 additional development neurotoxins: manganese, fluoride, chloropyrifos, dichlorohenotricholine, tetrachloroethylene, and plibrominated diethyl ethers. We postulate even more neurotoxins remain undiscovered. Following countries have stopped fluoridation: Austria, Belgium, Denmark, Finland, France, Germany, Greece, Iceland, Israel, Italy, Japan, Luxembourg, Netherlands, Norway, Portugal, Scotland, Spain, Sweden, and Switzerland. So I have brought copies of these for you so you can have them. I encourage you to go back and read that article. And I do believe this is forced medication. You already look at it. Everybody knows autism is increasing in this country. Thank you.
Judy Hengler.
Thank you. My name is Judy Hengler. I live at 1815 East 4th Street in Port Angeles. I'm here to talk about fluoridation. What are the effects on human body for the long-term use of drinking fluoridated water? Here are just a few of many concerns that science shows us. Fluoride effects on the brain. Fluoride effects on the endocrine system, fluoride effects on the thyroid, fluoride effects on the pineal gland, fluoride effects on insulin secretion diabetes, and fluoride effects on the immune system. Fluoride interactive synergistic effects with iodine, aluminum, etc. Fluoride effects on the reproductive system, fluorides and Down syndrome, fluoride effects on gastrointestinal system, fluoride effects on the liver, fluoride effects on the kidney, and fluoride and lung cancer. There is such a small margin of safety between a small benefit to teeth and a huge risk to health that it's time to halt this practice without delay. Calling for more research after it has been terminated is fine, but to do that research while we continue to dose our residents daily without firm knowledge of what levels can cause damage to health is preposterous. It amounts to the largest experiment with the public's health ever conducted. It's nothing else, it violates the Nuremberg Code, which strictly forbids human experimentation without the informed consent of the patient. The vast majority of individuals being exposed have never been given their consent, and until now, very few have been fully informed on the downside of overexposure to fluoride. Thank you, and I've included 6 sources of references for you to refer to.
Thank you. Next is Jim.
Come on, Dan. Where's your apple?
Oh, there you are, Dan. Hey, Jim, over here.
My name is Jim Bourget. I live at 313 North Ridgeview Drive in Port Angeles. Let me begin by saying I have great respect for the professionals who are here in support of water fluoridation. I think my dentist is exceptional and caring, Dr. Van Dyken. By the way, I grew up in a fluoridated community, and I had an unbelievable amount of cavities. Now, whether or not that was my behavior, I brushed and all that stuff. Anyway, what concerns me is virtually all of the professionals who have spoken in support of water fluoridation cannot and do not list any references for scientific studies supporting their claims of safety and effectiveness. As is always the case, we who are opposed to water fluoridation are expected to support our beliefs with scientific evidence, which we have done time and again and continue to do so. In the meantime, we have some professionals who say it should be left for the professionals to decide. Well, Eloise Kalin is eminently qualified as a physician with more than 50 years of experience in allergy and immunology. She conducted original scientific research, which resulted in over 20 publications in peer-reviewed journals, among many other accomplishments. There are countless others worldwide who are against water fluoridation: Nobel Prize winners, doctors, dentists, scientists, PhDs who have scientific evidence backing up their opinions. Whether or not you believe water fluoridation is safe and effective or not, the science showing that it is dangerous is overwhelming and cannot be denied. The risk is too great. The time to stop is now. Let's find a safer way to provide the topical treatment for those who want it. Additionally, it is astoundingly unacceptable for others to have the choice to put something in my body that I don't want. To me, it's remarkable that we're even having this discussion. The basic right of every human being on this planet is informed consent. If we don't want to use a medication, we don't have to. There is no denying the purpose of water fluoridation is to be used as a medication to lower the rate of cavities. There is little to no scientific proof that fluoridation is effective, at least in the water supply. There are mountains of evidence that it's extremely unsafe. The fact that it accumulates in our bodies should be enough to scare anyone. It is a toxic substance. I don't want it in my body, my children's body, my wife's body, or my grandson's. That is a right of choice we should be protected to make. I myself have a degree in environmental science from a university. Does that make me more qualified than a dentist or doctor to make these decisions? Does it make me more qualified than my family, friends, or neighbors? Maybe, maybe not. The important thing is that we should all be given the freedom of choice. That is the basic premise our country is based upon.
Jim, you need a sum up your remarks.
Okay, I've got one more paragraph. I saw a bumper sticker last week that I think is very appropriate to this discussion. It said, "Don't believe everything you think." Again, let's err on the side of caution. There's just too much evidence demonstrating that this is an unhealthy practice. Do the right thing. Protect our rights as provided by law and moral ethics. Put a stop to this dangerous, antiquated, and unproven policy. I'll leave you with this. Do you want to base your decision on a handful of opinions or a mountain of worldwide research? Thank you.
Susan Garner.
My name is Susan Dial, and I live at 321 Lane. I'm not a dentist. I'm not a doctor. I have been around children in the dental field for 15 years. Prior to that, I was a banker. I had no idea what about fluoride. At the last city council meeting, I felt that the council members and others, just like this last gentleman said, that we didn't bring enough evidence-based information. So I did my homework, and I did bring that to you. And this is from the CDC. This is from the World Health Organization. This is from the Public Health Department. All the bibliography is here. I did not print every report that I read, but I gave you the links, and there's over 50 that you can go look at. That has scientific proof that the studies show that the fluoride being put in the water did decrease caries. I'll pass that out to you after I'm done. So the result of many years of study and clinical trials and many, many papers written about the public, about public fluoridation, the benefit does outweigh the risk. I deal with that every day in our office. The benefit outweighs the risk. We take x-rays. There's risk in x-rays, but the benefit outweighs that risk. And for folks that don't have any choice to be able to purchase fluoride for themselves, the benefit of them getting the fluoride outweighs the risk. The studies that concluded with negative results often used very high amounts of fluoride in their tests. We have to remember our rate of fluoride is 0.07 parts per million. The tests that showed and cited negative effects that I read, that showed fluorosis, brittle bone disease, cancer, they were all done at fluoride rates of 250 parts per million. So just like anything else, if it's done in moderation, it can be good for you and there is a benefit. So I'd like to say in conclusion, the fluoride has a positive impact on the public. It has shown to reduce decay, which has been proven and written about over and over. But I'd like to say, on the other hand, we put chlorine in our water. And chlorine is put into our water specifically to kill living organisms in our water. I think that leads to question for all these folks that are worried about things in your water. I think chlorine in our water is very, very poisonous, and there is other alternatives, such as UV, to treat this water. So just think about how much chemicals you eat every day, fluoride is really good for your children's teeth. So with that, I just want to leave.
Greg Birch.
Dr. Greg Birch, I practice a little on Columbia Street in Port Angeles. And I'm just going to hit on a couple things because I think most of the information is going to come out of the public hearing. So let's keep this really short. First one is, you hear a conflicting claim, and that is the claim that 0.7 parts per million of fluoride in the water isn't effective on one hand. On the other side, they'll say, but it causes fluorosis. So how can you say 0.07 parts per million doesn't do anything, and on the other hand say, well, it's affecting your teeth? It does affect teeth, because we know the chemistry of how it affects teeth. We know how fluoride turns turns enamel from hydroxyapatite to fluorapatite, and that's why it's stronger. The second point is hysteria. And we've seen recently the effect that that hysteria about the measles vaccine had on a measles epidemic in Angeles, or an outbreak. And the thinking similar, like there's hysteria about fluoride, and yet we saw what happened with measles, and I don't want, as a professional, to see a similar thing happen, because I practice on both sides of this. I practice when there's no fluoride in the water, when we saw lots of juicy teeth, and now there's fluoride in the water, and we don't see as many. So that's all I have. I'll talk to you at the hearing.
Okay. Peter Murphy.
Peter Ripley, 114 East 6th Street, Apartment 102, Port Angeles. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council. 9 years ago, I ran for City Council. And I came and I brought this very question, suggested this very thing, that the people of the community should have a say in what they have in their big one. Simple. Fast forward to this year. And many years after I ran for City Council, many years, the same story over and over again. Fast forward to this year. You made a right call and calling for a public vote. But then I started to hear waffling and seeing waffling from some of you. Some of you are sitting on the council. And I'm shaking my head. I'm smelling waffles here. Really? And so I have to ask you, my fellow participants here, raise of hands, how many of you actually read the inserts of your utility bills? How many? Come on. Okay, how many? How many of you actually read the inserts of utility bills? Well, not very many. Not very many. Well, there you go, Mr. Mayor. Your vote just went down the drain, because you're not getting a fair assessment of what the people want. You know very well that those utility bills, only people are going to be interested in paying their bill. They're not going to look at the insert. They're going to toss it in the trash. So your vote is, yeah, what's with that? So I would urge you to reconsider that little move. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm Bill Osmussen. I'm a dentist with a master's in public health, so I do public health dentistry and general and cosmetic dentistry. I've been doing that for 37 years, and for the first 25, I promoted water fluoridation. Like my colleagues, I trusted the federal government and the American Dental Association. However, when I started looking at the research myself, it was like a knee in the gut. Fluoride doesn't do what we claimed it did in reducing decay like we thought. We're getting too much fluoride from many sources, and even the reduction of 30% in water is only giving us about a 14% reduction in total exposures. We're getting too much fluoride, especially some. And the risks far outweigh the benefits. I'm a dentist. Families come in to see me with mom and several kids, and the first child will look in their mouth and go, wow, look at all the stainless steel crowns and all of the composite fillings and everything. This child had a lot of problems. I look at the next child and I go, great. The next one, no problems. And I look at mom and say, why? Well, why the difference in your first child? I'm not putting the kids to bed with bottles of juice and milk anymore. So hopefully some of the public health education is getting through to different people and they're saying, oh, wow, we can prevent. We should be seeing decay decrease. I have a graph here that means a lot to me. And if you can see here, this is 1930 or 1990, 2000, even dropped more. Decayed teeth have dropped for all along for the last 80 years, 85 years. Fluoridation started, continued to drop. Toothpaste started, and it continued to drop. The big problem here is that what caused the decay to decrease before fluoridation started? The CDC would like you to think, or Health Division, would like you to think that the fluoridation reduced the decay before the fluoridation started. Doesn't make sense. So what caused it to go down? In all the research that you're reading, that I sent you hundreds of articles, where does it take into this confounding factor of what it was? It doesn't, because we have no clue what caused it to decrease, other than the natural course of diseases. Now, I talked, and the same thing worldwide, same thing if you compare the counties in Washington, it doesn't show a benefit. I have two research articles here I'm going to be giving to you. One's just an abstract, one is the article itself. And if you look at it carefully, over $100 a year at that time of dental expenses. And fluoridation, they thought, might help 67 cents, less than 1%. About a half a percent of what was being spent would be reduced with and cost reduction. A cost reduction, I think, is one of the better places to look because it takes in account a certain amount of the problems of dental of fluoride, because the tooth does become harder. It fractures more. It breaks more. We have to do more crowns in fluoridated communities than in non-fluoridated communities. Okay, so 67 cents in one research. Okay, and the other one was $3, and not the $38 district. Here's one on excess fluoride ingestion. This is the EPA data, who says that the FDA is in charge of water fluoridation, not the EPA. And that, of course, the FDA says that the EPA is responsible. The regulatory vacuum at the federal level means that nobody's looking at it. They all say, well, this is a local level decision. This is yours. You're the pharmacist. You're the toxicologist. You're the people in charge. If we look at this, at the different ages going across here, this, everybody above the black line is getting too much fluoride, according to the CDC. They don't include the infants down here. This is my little adding on there. They don't include, this is only 90th percentile. And this is when they raise the amount, saying it's even more safe than before.
I'm going to have to ask you some.
And that's it. Okay. Any questions, do please ask me. Thank you.
Good evening. I submitted my testimony with references to your city clerk and hope you've had a chance to look at it, because tonight I have an exciting new development to report, so I shall just summarize my intended speech. The letter signed by the Harvard deans in support of water fluoridation is refuted in that longer article. There appears to be a significant problem with potential loss of grant monies for Harvard if fluoridation does not continue. CDC is funded by Congress, $15.7 million for the year 2015 to promote fluoridation. This includes, quote, grants to increase resources for community water fluoridation and oral health infrastructure, end quote. CDC has every reason to want to keep fluoridation going. CDC claims benefits that are not scientifically supported. Lack of proof of efficacy is now publicly recognized by prestigious research workers, and especially in Europe, where entire nations are dropping it. Our local dentists admit reliance on CDC, but have not checked on the underlying studies. I'm glad to hear we have somebody tonight who brought in some studies on the other side. I'd like to see them. They operate on faith. PA citizens have provided the studies you need if science rather than faith is to determine the outcome of this controversy. Please continue to listen to the citizens. CDC's mantra of safe and effective is unconscionable where contents of the fluoride chemical is largely unknown and even worse, now known to be contaminated with measurable arsenic. Our breaking news. Works kids do not have better teeth compared to children in areas without water fluoridation. It took a team of community activists, computer consultant, a skilled attorney, and a statistician, plus half a year public disclosure request to uncover data locked away in a state file. The prize is data from SMILE surveys 2005 and 2010. In unfluoridated SQUIM, 8 and 9 year olds average 0.8673 cavities. Now, this is a state study. This is people hired by the Dental Foundation and the state, just about half and half, in order to do the study. So this is about as unbiased, at least biased from the other side, as we can get. All right, SQUIM's 8 and 9 year olds average 0.867 cavities. In Port Angeles, and this is in 2005, unfluoridated, the average was 0.9174 cavities, and the worst of the bunch was forks. 1.1270 cavities in forks. Low-income and minority children have higher cavity rates, which were considered in evaluating this data. This data has been checked now by a biased statistician, and we are told that it is statistically significant. We will have a much more detailed report a little bit later. I just got the statistical report about 24 hours ago. So this is a quickie. Thank you.
Thank you. Champlain Urban, 2345 East 3rd Avenue. You all know me as the videographer here, who takes the local government videos. But I actually hold a master's in health education. So I don't come to this with just no opinions. It's somewhere in here where it was. I'm going to talk tonight from a book by Christopher Bryson. The book is called Fluoride Deception. So I'll need that as the reference. Most likely all of our dentists, along with countless public health officials, have praised and promoted ad nauseum the use of fluoride in your toothpaste, in your drinking water. They call it a necessary part of our oral health program. But let's make this point clear. Fluoride is not an essential nutrient needed for our health, dental or otherwise. There's not one single metabolic process in your body that requires fluoride. On the contrary, fluoride is a cumulative poison. So we put in 0.07 in the water, but I might drink 10 glasses of water and you might only drink one. Cumulative effect over years. Approximately 98% of the fluoride you ingest in the water is absorbed into your blood through your gastrointestinal tract. From there, it enters your body through cellular tissues. On average, 50% of the fluoride you ingest each day gets excreted in your kidneys. I repeat, not one metabolic process needs or requires fluoride. So remember that cumulative is important, and it has been linked to reductions in IQ and array of health problems that people have talked about. But I come to this discussion looking for answers. I'm a person who likes things fixed. So, you know, let's do the best job we can while we're here. So our children up to 6 years old may need fluoride. It seems to be something that the dentists truly believe in, it, and with good reason. So let's develop a program that's funded by the fluoride money that we have in the budget that we take to the kids at school. You remember getting your polio vaccine at school? Let's get the dentist to the school, not the kids to the dentist's office. Figure out a plan how we do this. They get there, they examine the children's teeth, they apply the fluoride, and you work from that kitty of money to solve this problem. But for me and the rest of us, we have our choice to use fluoride. We can pick up the toothpaste, we can pick up the mouthwash, whatever. So I want choice, and let's give the kids an answer. Thank you.
I'm a board certified specialist in preventive medicine and public health, and I served for a long time as the Clallam County Health Officer, and I reside in the country outside Sequim. We've heard a lot of criticism that we're not presenting enough science to the council, and this is a task I would really relish. This format of 3-minute testimony doesn't really allow it. Science is complex. It has to be dealt with in its complexities. However, we're going to have an opportunity of a public hearing, and I think that will be a good time to do that. I would like to address a couple issues, though, that I think keep coming up again and again. And the first issue I would like to address is that of false balance. False balance is the belief that there are two opposing and equally valid positions to every issue. The media often falls into this trap. I've heard it from council members. You might be led to believe tonight that people, especially people in the science community, are somehow evenly divided on this. There's nothing that could be further from the truth. In the scientific community, the support for community water fluoridation as a public health intervention is overwhelming. That's why we keep telling you about the who's who list of scientific organizations that have supported this for a long time. These are not celebrity endorsements. These are the most esteemed, best trained science experts in this country, in the world, who exhaustively gone through this mountain of research, most of which is very badly done research. So it's a mountain of junk science with a handful of decent studies is what they waded through and come to the same conclusion that the truth is exactly the opposite of what you're hearing. Is that the evidence of effectiveness is overwhelming, and the evidence of safety is overwhelming. There's actually only one proven adverse effect from community water fluoridation. Everything else you've heard is alleged in junk science studies that have been thoroughly refuted. If people want to go through this evidence, what I suggest is a number of countries have actually done national reviews where expert bodies have gone through all sides of the issue and then published reports. The UK and Ireland have done this. The most recent one is New Zealand, which was published in 2014, goes through all the current research. So I welcome the opportunity to address things like the Harvard study, which is being thoroughly misrepresented here, and in fact does not draw the conclusions that people are saying it's done, or this bogus issue of arsenic in the water. Even if you accept Dr. Kalin's data as to how much is in fluorosilicic acid, once diluted, this comes out to be 0.007 parts per billion. Which is an insignificant amount, and without any evidence of health effect whatsoever. Thank you. So, bottom line, this debate, this is science versus pseudoscience, and it's not really a science-based debate. It's about one side that plays by the rules of science, and the other that is about fear and confusion and sowing doubt. But it's not a coincidence that all the reputable science experts in this country, the vast majority of them, have clearly come down on one side of this issue. Thank you.
I'm really struggling with the next thing. I think it's Harvey.
Kalin.
Okay.
Thank you. I live in Squim, Kane Lane in Squim. I want to thank the mayor and the council and people for this forum. I would like to say that I've been following this debate since it really began a year ago in August, and that's, I believe, when Dr. Locke first addressed his council. And what I've done for the council is I have transcription, word-for-word transcription of what he's been saying, and I passed that to you. It was a 12-page document, and now I've got some more to add to it, but I will do that, and for his inimitable words. And he repeated again tonight one of the things that he likes to say, that there's two things, there's science and there's pseudoscience. And I don't think there's a person in this room who wouldn't agree that we're on the side of science and that there is such a thing as pseudoscience. The problem has been, it has been a year. And as far as I know, Dr. Locke has not put his cards on the table. Where's the science, Mr. Locke? Have you given this council any studies? I haven't seen them. I haven't heard anybody else who's actually seen these studies.
What?
Address your comments to the council.
Oh, yeah, thank you. I would say that we should not wait to see the science at a meeting in next October or whenever. It's time to put the science.
This is a complicated world we live in today, and we can no longer look at anything in isolation. We have been exposed and are being fed chemicals, toxic chemicals, of all different sorts and types, daily, in our food, in our water with fluoridation and chlorine, everywhere we turn. Our government is giving chemical corporations the authority to poison us. And it's not just one. Maybe one toxin won't hurt us, but it's the accumulation of all of these toxins that's gonna get us, and particularly the children whose bodies are not strong enough yet to handle all of this, and each one is different and handles it differently. As for scientific research, I just got this afternoon, so excuse me, I haven't had a chance to do it, but it's currently a professor in disease prevention at Stanford University, has published the most widely accessed article in the history of public library of science. And it's entitled, Why Most Published Research Findings Are False. And in the report, he states, there is increasing concern that most current published research findings are false, and mostly because they are financed by the larger corporations that are going to make money off of their findings, whatever they want to say is true. There's other people that have come out and said that too. It's time to rethink our current medical research and see the bigger picture. There's a Harvard study, and one of these guys is a longtime editor-in-chief of the New England Medical Journal. I mean, these are very valid people who are turning their backs against a lot of the research papers that are out there. You are going to have to just stop and look inward and use our common sense and our intuition. Common sense says ingesting toxic chemicals is not good for you.
Okay, that's all who signed up and said they wanted to speak. We've gone well past the 15.
Sorry, excuse me, I signed up.
What is your name?
Dr. Kristen Pat.
Sorry, I can't hear you. Dr.
Crystal
Tapp,
T-A-C-K.
That's the sheet I gave you, Dan.
Well, you did indicate you wanted to speak. That's why I didn't follow.
Oh! I thought that was...
Go ahead.
Okay. I thought that's part of the sign up. I'm sorry. We need to stop the two-dimensional thinking and go deeper. Oh, Dr. Kristen Tack, 344 House Road, Square, Washington. We need to stop the two-dimensional thinking and look deeper. For instance, why did Harvard State support for fluoride? Dr. Eloise Gillen didn't parrot the study. She did her research and has shown how following the money works, sadly enough, even in our most prestigious of hallowed halls. How sad the cost of greed to our country that touts let freedom ring. Who here has done their homework? A previous patient from Seattle dropped by my office today and donated her precious vacation time to come listen and support. And when I mentioned Eloise Kalin, she said, I know her. Back in 1985, when I was really sick from working in a printing shop, none of the doctors knew about toxic effects of chemicals, so we were on our own. We got our hands on a book called How to Survive the Toxic World and found a reference to Dr. Kalin, came out and talked to her. And she confirmed that we had chemical sensitivity. Perhaps it's a good reminder for all of us that Dr. Kalin was a pioneer in chemical sensitivity at a time that was unheard of. In Washington, D.C., she had a private practice half-time and was doing clinical research half-time with double-blind studies to prove to her colleagues that chemical sensitivity existed. Now it's common knowledge, thanks to brave doctors like her, who dared to think, for themselves and see what the obvious was rather than stay in the safe box of what we're told to think. She has been in a practice since 1946 and is 96 years old. She is still brilliant and, as you see, going strong and still strives to help her colleagues and community to see the obvious. I guess she is doing something right. Dentist Dr. Renner Johnson, who has patients like tonight, if you didn't know about this meeting soon enough, says there are thousands and thousands of articles exposing the dangers of fluoride at this point. What would you rather have, a cavity or brain damage? Renner is 78, still working, and patients come from far and wide to see him. He must be doing something right. It is important to keep your ethics strong and remember that most dentists are focused only on teeth and have one of the most highest suicide rates of any profession. Could that be, in fact, some influence of the toxic exposure? Dr. Kinnon has more than half a century of observing the whole person, and I personally have had 30 years to see the health of people that have been exposed to significant doses of fluoride, which I would be happy to discuss with you. This issue is so much bigger than teeth. Dr. Paul Hunt, who at our last meeting was slurred with pseudoscience, and tonight junk science, taught toxicology at a university level for 23 years and has spent the last 19 of his retirement gathering studies that expose the dangers of fluoride because he's so alarmed of our future. Look for the credentials, look to the experience, look to the brave of heart who do not cower before opposition. What about taking people's rights away? Fluoride in the water is not a right. Being safe in your home is a right. What about the folks like Jessie who spoke last time about how sick she got from fluoride, and the Christies who couldn't come tonight because she didn't know about this meeting until she was on vacation? Who has to move their family from PA when she could no longer feel safe in her home due to the fluoridated water? I would love to see the statistics on how many people moved from PA at that time to avoid fluoridation, and how many more would have if they could afford it, and the same with getting the reverse osmosis to get the fluoride out of the water. How many people would have, and how many people did? You have the power to take we the people's rights away. I personally avoid eating in restaurants in Port Angeles due to fluoridation, and know many others that make that choice as well.
You need to sum up your remarks, please.
Okay, and out it goes. It's not saving a penny. It's saving. It's costing on many levels. A pediatrician 10 years ago chose not to talk with me and chose not to show me any research. He said he had tons of research. The same thing happened 10 years ago. So I produced my own over the next months, and I can guarantee you Eloise has 10 or 100 times more than I have. She dug deep for true answers. Please respect your elders. Please do your homework. Your power is sacred. You are the chiefs of the village, and their well-being is in your hands. And this time, we need all the intelligence we can muster. I was raised on Crest fluoridated toothpaste. I liked how it tasted and probably swallowed plenty. And I have plenty of cavities. And I have to read this to make sure I say it all. My son has no fluoridation exposure, has no cavities, and is one of the most brilliant, clear-minded people I know. Okay. There's a lot more now.
Okay, thank you. I will continue down with the agenda then. Are there any late items on the agenda?
Yeah, one more person.
Excuse me, I missed the sign-in sheet. This is my first council meeting. I apologize, but my apologies. If I can have just a moment, I'll be incredibly brief.
I'll give you 3 minutes.
Thank you.
Name and address.
My name is Noah Mish. I currently reside at 311 East 10th Street, and I just moved back into town last Friday. I spent the last few years in Portland. Grew up around here, been inspired, wanted to come back to become an urban farmer and help bring a sense of food to the community and young people that was lacking when I was a children, and now I'm very interested in it. Real quick, I have just a moment from one of these studies, these Harvard studies, and I'd like to read you just the first paragraph here. You can find it on harvard.edu. If you search, you know, fluoride and neurological, it'll pop right up. And it was published July 25th, 2012. For years, health experts have been unable to agree on whether fluoride in the drinking water may be toxic to the developing human brain. Extremely high levels of fluoride are known to cause neurotoxicity in adults, and negative impacts on memory and learning have been reported in rodent studies, but little is known about the substance's impact on children's neurological development. In a meta-analysis, researchers from the Harvard School for Public Health and the China Medical University in Shenyang for the first time combined 27 studies and found strong indication that fluoride may adversely affect cognitive development in children. Based on these findings, the authors say that this risk should not be ignored, and that the more research on fluoride impact on the developing brain is warranted. And I'm reading directly from your article here. Now, this study, it was a conglomeration between obviously the two countries and the two schools. And now in China, the risk of the fluoride is well established. As people have mentioned, it's naturally in groundwater. And there's areas of China where it is heavily concentrated, so they've done a lot of this research. The lead author, Ann Choi, this is a direct quote, stated, virtually no human studies in this field have been conducted in the United States. And part of the study, they analyzed associations with IQ, another member said this, and in more than 8,000 children of school age, all but one study suggested that the high fluoride content in water may negatively affect cognitive development. You know, we all have a choice to make our own opinions, right on the internet. I, as I mentioned, have been in Portland, where I was very inspired. This is a vibrant, growing, one of the fastest growing cities in the United States. Young people are interested in politics. It's a fun thing, and you know, it is not a fluoridated city. So I leave you with that, and those are my 2 cents. Thank you so much for the time.
No, there is not.
Mr. Mayor, I would like to request that at our last meeting we got a report on the increased amount of calls from our fire department significantly over last year. May I request that we get a monthly update on the increased calls from our fire department? I think that would be, I'd really like to hear what's happening, why, and what. What calls are increasing, if that's amenable to the fire chief.
So you're looking for a summary report on what the calls?
I would be happy to do that.
No problem.
Thank you.
Okay, let's move to the consent agenda. We have 2 items. Anybody want to pull either of the 2 items? Not, let me read it. City Council minutes of July 7, 2015, and the expenditure approval list for July 11th, 2015 through July 24th of 2015, the amount of $3,525,260.42. This is Council's pleasure.
Motion to approve is read.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any further discussion? Hearing all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Because so many people are here tonight regarding the fluoride issue, I'm going to move the agenda item fluoride under H2. To the next item that the council will be discussing. So we'll jump to that fluoride discussion.
Okay, I'll begin with that, and I think then Dan will conclude. At the special meeting last week, the council voted to appoint a committee for the...
Bill, I don't think your microphone's on. I can't hear you.
Is it any better now?
A little bit.
Try this one. Does that work better? Last week, the council voted to appoint committees to draft pro and con statements for a proposed ballot measure. The council then did not vote to go ahead with the ballot measure, but instead voted to conduct a poll. So instead of going through the formal election process, there will be a poll. The poll will include the city water customers as well as the PUD water customers who receive fluoridated water. So that was the action of the council last week, and then at that time, as I understand, you sent the staff back to come back at this meeting with some details on how to make that happen. So tonight, we have some of those details. First is a resolution. The resolution would set the language of the poll, and you will recognize that the resolution is very similar to the resolution that was presented at the last meeting. But at the last meeting, the resolution was intended to satisfy the statutory guidelines for a ballot measure in a formal election. We're not doing a formal election this time, but the statutory language is intended to present a fair, unbiased question to
already had that language. I made some changes to switch it from a formal election format to a poll. But the basic question is still intended to be unbiased and free and neutral. So that was one issue that needed to be addressed. So it's anticipated then that this poll would be sent out by the city to the city customers and by the PUD to the PUD customers. The poll would include the ballot question or the poll question and the explanatory statement that was prepared. It would also include the statements for and against, because the council had already appointed those committees. They could still go ahead and do their work, and that would be included with the language that would go out. We would also include a pre-addressed envelope so that they would return the poll. They would have the envelope to return the poll. So that covers the distribution. The next item would be the collection and counting of the polls. Now, on this point, we have at least a couple of options, but we don't have any final details. I can tell you that it is not the intention of the city staff that anyone from the city would be involved in counting the polls. So we would probably have the ballot or the polls returned by mail to a neutral location, such as a post office box, and that we would arrange for someone other than city staff to be involved in the counting of the poll, so that we would just basically get the poll results coming back to us from a third party. We don't have those details set up yet. And so the final consideration that the council had in the resolution that you have tonight, there is an authorization for the city manager to go ahead and complete those arrangements to have an independent third party collect the polls, council polls, and simply return results to the city. Final item is to select the date and the timing. We would want the polls to go out to the PUD customers and to the city customers on the same day. We would like to have the deadline for both of them be the same day. And Dan has some more thoughts on that. I'll let him take over.
Thank you, Bill. There is two items that you do need to take care of tonight. One is the resolution that Bill went over. The other is setting a public hearing date. And the council did request that the staff look at dates in October, and we did that. But there are two primary reasons for setting that public hearing date. But before I go through those, the one thing we did discuss at the last council meeting and talked about the possibility of having the format for that public hearing and educational forum, that you could have the for and against committee do a presentation on a certain amount of time for each of those groups, and then after that, let citizens come up and give their input to the council. The two primary reasons for setting a public hearing date tonight is that you do have a for and against committee, and it allows them to understand what that timeline is for their preparation for both the public hearing that they would participate in, but also the for and against statement that would be mailed out with the advisory poll. I think it's important to give them kind of the time frame that they would be working with so they can go away and start that preparation and know what their deadlines for that are. The other reason is that obviously by setting a public hearing date, if it's set up as an educational forum, the logical way to deal with it is that shortly after that is to send out the advisory poll, and then based on that, based on the mailing, then you have your deadline date. What staff did is made a recommendation that
the week following the public hearing, the advisory poll could be mailed out during that next full week, get them all out. And then using that last Friday, 21 days later would be the recommendation that the deadline would occur. And so all you need to do tonight is pick a hearing date, and then those other dates will occur, or you could modify those dates if you wish. That was just our recommendation. So since the council wanted the public hearing in October, we provided the council with 4 days, and they're the Thursdays in October. We're going to be busy, unfortunately, with other things like budget, and this is one other item to add. But those Thursday dates are October 1st, 8th, the 15th, and the 22nd. And then again, once you select a public hearing date, the following week is the recommendation that the mailing would occur, and then 21 days after the end of that week would be the deadline. And staff is here to answer any questions that you have.
Okay, thank you. Let's deal with the date first. So the council should have an opportunity to check the calendars regarding the four proposed dates on Thursday in October. Is there one that's a preference for the council?
Mr. Mayor, I'd actually like to break out a council discussion of actually two public hearings, and for sake of discussion this evening, again, I would propose two public hearings yet to be set by council. The first one would be the for and against, and as we've witnessed tonight, we've had an awful lot of people coming in here giving us testimony. Perhaps the second public hearing could be a public comment session followed by staff mailing out the ballots. I'd like to hear more from my fellow council members.
Well, speaking with the date for a second, I'm not opposed to what Councilman Whittle just said. I think that may make some sense. The first is not council weekend. I'm staying on vacation. I would not want to do first. All right, first is gone. The 8th on my calendar, we're meeting with the City of Victoria. That was a date we were working towards for meeting with the Council of Victoria. And so I would not want to jeopardize that date.
Just as a little follow-up to that, that date will likely get pushed.
I'm not too happy about that. I think we've been pushing that date already quite a lot, and I'd hate to see us push it again. So I'd be happy to have it sooner, but I don't want to have it later.
It's not so much on our end that the date will likely get pushed.
That's even more reason why I would not want to see it pushed later. So I would definitely prefer the 15th or the 22nd. I'm available for either of those days. And if we're going to do Councilman Whittle's suggestion, we need to vote the 15th and the 22nd for some vote. But I can see that if we just have an hour for the committee's reports and presentations, how many hours are we going to have for public comment? So it might be nice to separate those two. So that's my thought.
Other comments?
I guess my thought is that we've been getting a lot of public comment already. And so I ideally would like to get the public hearing done and then have public comment that day and then kind of put this thing to bed. But that would be my preference. I can circle the date if that works best for me, but see Victoria. I guess either one of the 15th. I guess in between the 8th, I would prefer the 22nd or the 15th.
I can do the 15th or
22nd. Mr. Mayor and other members, I had hoped to be on the first, probably the first 2 weeks of October.
The 22nd work best for you then?
Well, yes, it would have to. But, matter of this significance, I could probably make arrangements to be back in 15 minutes.
But the 22nd works for you.
But the 22nd, after the time.
All right. Lee, what date works best for you?
Anything.
They all work.
15th or 22nd are fine with me.
All right, so the 15th, 22nd seems to work well for everybody. So let's narrow it down one more day here. Which one?
15.
Pat, you can do it.
Can you do the 15?
Yes.
Is it a cause of hardship for you to be back for that? If so, we can just go to the 22nd. I agree. Everybody else seems to accept 22nd.
I think everybody thinks the 22nd is better, so.
In reality, to keep this motion going forward, all we need is a quorum. So, again, what is that, five or four?
Well, if the 15th is tough on Pat, by all means, let's go to the 22nd. Then that seems to
be right. No, this is.
Well, if Sissy asks for
the 22nd. Sissy asks for the 22nd also.
Let's do that. All right, it seems to be that we have a majority of the council wants the 22nd. So, you don't need a motion, just direction on that, is that correct? You need a motion.
I think under the circumstances, it'd be better to have all these actions done by motion.
Okay, I would entertain a motion.
I'd entertain a motion that we set the date of October 22nd, 2015 for the public hearing for the fluoridation issue.
Second. Move to second. We're here for discussion.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Did we come with a consensus of the 22nd will be for and against? That's my question.
Yes.
If someone could answer. I appreciate it. All right. Thank you.
Any further discussion?
What time of the day are we talking about?
Well, let's just see. Let's pass the motion first, and then we can talk about time. Okay. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. We will hold the public hearing on the 22nd of October, beginning at 6 o'clock.
I suspect this hearing is going to go a long ways.
Beginning at 6 o'clock. And give each side an hour?
Well, we talked about that earlier, half an hour for each side and then public hearing.
Well, I like the idea of coming back at us afterwards.
I'd like to share with not only council but also members of the public that chose to attend tonight. I'm sure myself, I have, as well as I'm sure other council members, we're already getting bombed from organizations from the East Coast that want to weigh in on this. This could become ground zero, but you know what? In the meantime, I want everyone to have their say in our community. And the for side, for against, may choose to use somebody like that. But the fact of the matter is, I just want to bring this out as much as possible to the public with an advisory vote. So I think a longer time period on each side. So if we can set the parameters of our initial meeting, to even say, I don't know, 2 hours, two and a half, three, whatever, we can agree to something and then split it in half. And then following a week later, then we follow up with comments from, we're going to probably be under another time constraint again. What's happened tonight is evidence, but, you know, maybe we can at first set the initial time period, the first hour or something, for make sure that all the residents of BUD customers that get our water have a chance to address us, followed by outside residents on the peninsula or even from the East Coast if someone chose to attend this meeting. We have to anticipate that. So,
good, Brent.
I think there is a consensus here right now, and I agree with you, Mayor, that we do it an hour each on the 22nd and then on the 29th, which is not, it's the end of the month. Not a meeting. We did allow at least a couple hours for public comment on the 29th, which is also a Thursday that. So I think that works with the council. Why don't we move in that direction? And if I understand the explanatory statement, then we would have the response mailed out no later than the next week, and 21 days after that, there would be a coming. And I think that would get it to us sometime at the end of November, beginning of December, right? And that's plenty of time to make the decision, before May, so there'll probably be some consideration in time that we want to sort of look at that issue. I would note in the explanatory statement that this is being adopted by the council, not in a special meeting in July, but on a meeting on the fourth day of August.
Okay, I tend to agree with your comments about an hour apiece and then come back and get how they come in and have their say, and then a week later we send the ballots out. Is there a consensus on that?
And I also say, you know, let's give a little time break in between so people can stretch and so that they're, because to sitting
down. Well, it starts to go long,
do one side, take a little break for the next side.
I do ask that you print very clearly. I have a hard time reading some of the names when we get time down to read the public comments. So I'll entertain a motion to do that. Hold the second public meeting on the 29th.
I'd make that motion.
Second.
That would be for public comment?
Public comment only.
Yep. So there's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Not hearing all those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, that's a little bit 22nd to 29th. That's the beginning of 6 p.m. All right, let me read the resolution and we can have that discussion. The resolution City of Council of the City of Port Angeles, Washington, providing for the submission of the water system customers of the City of Resolution of the City Council of the City of Port Angeles, Washington, providing for the submission to the water system customers of the city and to the water customers in the unincorporated county who receives city water from Public Utility District Number 1 of an advisory poll seeking citizens' input regarding the fluoridation of the city's municipal water supply. I'm going to read the language, the proposed language for the poll. The City of Port Angeles is contractually obligated to continue fluoridation of the municipal water supply until May 18, 2016. After that, fluoridation will continue unless the City Council takes action to discontinue the practice. Should the City of Port Angeles continue fluoridating its municipal water supply after May 18, 2016? Okay, any discussion question, Council?
I move that we pass the resolution
as read. Do I need a motion to begin discussion?
Yeah, we can do it for the first time. We can do it whenever you want to.
I'll second that.
All right, so we have the motion is to adopt the resolution as read?
Yep.
With the language? Okay, discussion?
I will support this.
I know, so I missed the last meeting, but prior to that, I was pretty vocal about not wanting to have a ballot item on the next after the next election, and I still feel real good about that for a couple different reasons. But this format, I think, is going to be a good representation of the actual users of the fluoridated water. Whereby an election, we couldn't include the PUD customers, so that eliminates them. And then it's an off election year, and traditionally there's a whole lot less of a turnout, a smaller turnout. And then it's only registered voters, and that leaves out a whole bunch of people. So I think by going with this, like Mr. Ripley was right on, you know, not everybody reads their newsletter, their bill.
Utility bill.
About 55-60% of the people in the audience indicated they do. If we only get that, it's going to be far, far greater input than what we have on the ballot. So I think this is probably the most realistic way to go.
Well, we're mailing this out to everybody, not putting it in the utility.
Precisely. Oh, okay, mailing this, so that's even better.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, I had some vocal in the past, so I'm going to just summarize my remarks and say that I'm really pleased that this evolution of this matter has come down to where we are tonight. I think we have expressed a generosity of spirit. And to hear the public, and especially adding the second vote, appreciate Councilmember Webb's willingness to urge that, and I think that makes sense too. I'm certainly very feel that about what we're doing.
I just would add that one of the things I hope at the end of the last meeting is that we get a consensus of what we want to do, and I believe we did that. I think that we have a lot of different opinions about this, but we have a consensus that this is the way we should look at it, and I'm happy to see that.
And let me say, I would be remiss if I didn't thank the rest of you for being tolerant of my schedule. But my wife will be discussing that.
Okay, anybody else?
All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. One last piece of business, when we first started talking about these public hearings, we were going to have another one in December. I'm assuming that one goes away now with the second public hearing that we're going to have in the October. Is that correct?
I made the motion for the hearing in December before all the rest of this came about. I put my second willing to forego the second public hearing. I said, yeah.
Okay, good.
Mr. Mayor, I've asked Council's permission to leave early this evening. I've got a prior engagement.
Across the street.
All right.
You can be excused.
Yep. You take a break.
I ask the Council one break. This will recess for 5 minutes.
I want somebody to
forget that.
No, I was trying to let Corey in.
It's better now.
Okay, we have lost Councilor Wood. Let's go back in session again. It's just coming to my attention, we have a councilman from the city of Port Townsend this evening. I'd like to welcome you.
Welcome.
Your name is again?
Deborah Stinson.
Deborah Stinson?
Mm-hmm.
Welcome.
Nice to have you here.
You want to get started with that?
No, please.
Let's go to Section G, the Budget Amendment Number 2.
Mayor, members of council, there is one small change that Sharon will be able to go over very briefly in less than a minute, and then we'll be able to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay.
Tonight we have the second reading of Budget Amendment Number 2, and since the first reading 2 weeks ago, we have added $47,000 in additional expenditure from the lodging tax fund, and that will bring the fund up to the point where council has already approved and added those expenditures into the marketing contract with the chamber. So this is just the final step in making that official. And then another transfer will go into the Fine Arts Center fund in the amount of $6,300. You can see these changes are listed on page G2 of your packet. And in the Fine Arts Center fund, the transfer in is shown as revenue. And then the allocation of expenditures are also included. So tonight we're asking for a second reading of the ordinance and then to approve.
Sure, what was the original transfer to the criminal lodging tax fund to the assumes the chamber and marketing program? How come it wasn't the full amount the first time? Why did you ask for it?
The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee did not meet early enough in 2014 to get these into the original budget, and then we just missed it in the First Amendment. So this was actually brought to council. Nathan, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was back in December that council approved.
I remember those meetings, yes. Quite well,
yes.
Thank you.
So it's been a while. So this will just formalize that.
All right, thank you. Mm-hmm. Other questions, council? Not going to read the ordinance, nor is the city of Port Angeles, Washington, amending the 2015 budget and funds.
Mr. Mayor, I move we pass the ordinance as read.
Second. It's been moved to second. Further discussion?
I just wanted to let people in the audience who weren't at our work session understand that the city is facing some significant issues here. And so this is causing us to really dig down on how we're going to do things. So this budget amendment is different than others that I've approved. So.
Anyone else? If not, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. All right, let's move to Section 8 again, a resolution in support of potential future consolidation of PenCom.
Jefferson County.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. One, you've acknowledged that Deborah Stinson is here as a representative for his aid.
Taser it.
Are those two microphones too close together?
It's me.
We were getting.
Is that better?
Probably the water.
Deborah Stinson is here tonight as a member of the Port Angeles City Council, but she's also here as the chairperson of the
Port County.
Or Port County, what did I say? Jefferson County Government Board of PenCom. Carl Hatton, who is the director of Jefferson County's Communication Center, is also here. And Steve Armour, who is the director of our Communication Center, Animal Communication Center of PenCom, is also here to answer your questions tonight. What you have before you tonight is a statement of support in the form of a resolution that would allow us to explore further or complete regionalization, perhaps in the future, of the 911 centers in both Jefferson County and Clallam County. Jefferson County maintains a 911 center that's completely separate now from Clallam County. We maintain one as well. It's completely separate from Jefferson County, with some exceptions. And the exceptions are that a few years ago, probably around 2009, I think, the federal government mandated narrowbanding of our radio systems, and some of you may recall that. But what happened as a result of narrowbanding is the backup centers that we separately maintain in Jefferson County and Clallam County to back up our main 911 centers were rendered obsolete. To bring our backup center here, which really was a much reduced capability, up to any kind of level where it could operate for us, we would have had to invest $100,000 most likely in radio systems and things like that. We made a decision in cooperation with Jefferson County back then to begin to work toward interoperability so that Jefferson County could become our backup center and we could become their backup center. In the last few years, we have purchased identical CAD systems, New World CAD systems, computer-aided dispatch systems, the Viber 911 phone system we own is identical to one in Jefferson County. We are working toward replacing our radio consoles with identical consoles where we would house, for example, Jefferson County radios, and they would house Clallam County radios, which is a further step toward regionalization. And at some point, we will be able to merge our CAD systems and our law enforcement record management systems into a single system. And so why would we want to do that? Well, for example, right now we work in support of each other in both the fire and police capacity with mutual aid agreements. However, once a Port Angeles police officer, for example, crosses the Clallam County border into Jefferson County, his mapping capabilities disappear completely. Our ability, if we could correct that, it would enhance tremendously the safety of our public safety personnel in both police and fire. That communication abilities and things like that would improve. So, as pointed out in the memo that I submitted in your packet, there's, I think, budget savings that might be found further down the road. As enhancing the safety of our personnel, and I'm not remembering the other thing that's in there. Certainly operational efficiencies. And I think what we're asking, or the rule that we're asking you to let us embark on, is very complex. It's not just a simple matter of saying, hey, that's a great idea, let's do it tomorrow. We operate under different governance structures. The assets that are controlled by PenCom are different than what is controlled, for example, by Jefferson County. Our revenue streams are different. The tax initiatives that we operate are different. There's many things that Carl Hatton, as a regional 911 director, would be asked to identify and then seek solutions for. Historically, or what that has been accomplished in other areas of the country, it's an effort that has taken several years. But I do believe it's the right thing to do, and I think that what we're asking to do tonight is take a baby step in the direction toward potential future regionalization. And and I'm excited about it, Frank. The biggest impediment to resizing dispatch centers is not technology. We can overcome technology. It's almost purely political. And so Jefferson County, through the passage of the resolution as you have before you, has made a statement that supports the further exploration of the topic. But I have to tell you that our meetings with the Jefferson County personnel that included Deborah and Carl were very positive. And I think a statement from our city council in support of regionalization would be very helpful to us and would allow us to move forward, for what I believe to be the benefit of the taxpayers of both Jefferson County and Carl County.
Okay, questions?
Mr. Mayor, I love this concept. I think it's efficient. I think it's for the greater good of our communities. It makes sense for events seen or unseen that can happen in the future. I love the spirit of cooperation that has it has the potential for intergovernmental cooperation here. But mostly, from a public safety point of view, I feel that this is, I can see this broader vision. I think it's a great step forward. At this time, it's not costing us anything to look into this. We are just moving in that direction. But I believe this would be it's the time for us to do that, and I would not wish to hinder or delay this at all. So thank you and to everyone who's addressing this and asking us to be a part of this effort. I think it's very positive for our entire community. Thank you.
I would like to second that. I think this is really important, and I actually would like to see if we can expand that. Can we get, you know, look into regional things for like solid waste or some of the marine water qualities, all those things where I think it would be a win-win for all of us if we could collaborate together. So thank you very much for bringing this up. I think it's wonderful.
As we explore this, one of the things that I think is critical is to make sure we improve redundancy for emergency situations rather than whatever we do regionally, that it helps to improve redundancy. So I'm sure that's one of the things you'll be addressing. So
I've known Deborah for, well, several years now. I saw you become a very impressed with her willingness to be collaborative, and when she comes out here as a representative of the council, I think that the council, Port Townsend, must be solidly behind this, or they wouldn't have brought this matter forward. I've been sitting with Brad and Nathan, and some of the rest of you, well, Sissy, of course, too, sits in a bi-county organization that meets once a month, or two elected officials and other civic leaders in both Jefferson and Clown County get together once a month or more to talk about how we can work together. I think this is certainly consistent in our overall effort. Those of us have been these two counties who routinely meet and talk about how we can be smarter and more strategic and just working with the benefit of both communities and both counties. And I just see this is hugely consistent with that effort. And I'm certainly supporting what we're about to embark on.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that anytime we get beyond the political impediments of progress, it's a real, real good thing. So I think we're heading down the right path, and I commend all you guys for your hard work. I'm in favor.
I agree. I've always been a supporter of government agencies working together to minimize any duplications that we may be providing. Even though I'm leaving the council at the end of the year, I'd like to hear see this council begin to discuss the possible consolidation of the local fire districts. That process began
I think my first year on the council, we started that process, got very, very close, and at the last minute, for budgetary reasons and stuff, it didn't come together, and we dropped the issue. But I know that Councilmember Downey, I think you were sharing, were on the committee that met with Fire District 2 commissioners to consolidate. I think that would provide better service to their district. It would provide, I think, better service to the city of Port Angeles. Well, off the subject here, we're talking about consolidations. I think while we talk about law enforcement stuff, I think it's important that we take another look at the fire departments and see whether we can find a way to consolidate those two to have better efficiencies. Anyway, I'll entertain a motion from the council.
I would make a motion to kind of friend. I would recommend the council pass this attached resolution supporting the further acceleration of the regionalization of the 911 services on the Olympic Peninsula. So maybe my
resolution needs to be read.
Yes.
Okay, let me read the resolution of the City Council of the City of Port Angeles, Washington, authorizing the Port Angeles Chief of Police or his designee is authorized to explore consolidation of the administrative functions of Peninsula Communications with Jefferson County 911 and the future consolidation of the two dispatch entities into a Region 911 communication system.
They have too many words there. You don't need authorizing it, authorizing to explore.
So I would make a motion to approve the resolution as read.
Second
then. So move a second to approve the resolution as read.
I was wondering if, Deborah, did you have any, if you had raised your hand to speak, or did you want to do that?
Well, first of all, thank you for your support in the resolution. And the only thing I wanted to speak to was a clarification. Patrick had mentioned that because I was here, meant the whole city council is fully behind this, and it is. I am the city's representative on the JeffCom 911 board, which I now chair. But actually, I'm here to represent that board. It is a separate entity from the city or the county. It's its own standalone organization at this point. So I'm actually representing that. This same resolution or one just like it has been signed by the board, and that is representing of the city of Port Townsend, the county of Jefferson County, and all our fire districts and our sheriff. So those are the folks that are already behind this. And thank you again for your support.
Thank you. Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
So can I just say one final comment? I just want you to become familiar with Carl Hatton. Carl is a former employee of PenCom and a supervisor, multi-supervisor of PenCom, who accepted the director's position at JeffCom 2 years ago.
Yep.
And I understand he's done a wonderful job in Jefferson County, and he certainly did that for us when he was employed here. So really what I think right now is we have the right man at the right time for the right job, and I'm very optimistic about this whole process. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Yep. All right, let's move on to considerations, the drought update.
Thank you, Council. What I'm proposing today is that we move to stage 3 drought shortage conditions. As of today, the river flow of the Elba is at 260 cubic feet per second. So we've broken that 300 CFS. We broke it about 2 weeks ago, but then there were some rains and it's been hovering around 300, but now it's starting to drop again. Normally we don't break 300 CFS until late September, early October. So we're 2 months ahead of schedule due to the drought conditions. What we are intending to do for stage 3 is to several things we want to accomplish. One, we want to ramp up our education, and we'll be delivering to every home and business flyers
On one side is a description of stage three water shortage, what some of the requirements are. On the back side is general water conservation measures they can put in place. Second thing is, with this ramped up education, we begin to change habits of water use. One of the last things we want to do is go from a stage one or stage two immediately to a stage four, if that happens, and everybody goes into a shock factor. And that's one we want to eliminate, is slowly ramp up education, increase changing of habits of how we use water, and then eliminate the, oh my gosh, we didn't expect this, and now we have to go into drastic conditions with no preparation of our residents and businesses. On the back of the memo, we list some of the restrictions we'd like to put in place. None of them, if you read, are onerous. They do not drastically impact the businesses or residents, how they go about their doing their business. It's just changing how they use water while still accomplishing using water for washing your sidewalks, your driveways, watering your lawns at night or early in the morning to eliminate evaporation. And one of the things that we will be implementing is odd even. So if your resident is odd, you water on odd days. If it's even, you water on even days. Not onerous at all, but it begins to change habits. And that's what we're looking for. Now there is a sixth option, is such other uses, such other restrictions as council deems appropriate. We can come back to you at a later date, maybe in August, later in August or September, if there are reasons to do so. But I think this is a good start to begin going to stage three. I've had the question, okay, so what is this going to change in the river, and how's it going to improve the fish? Well, I don't have a good answer for that. What it will do, and what I think we need to focus on, is to ensure that we are the drivers of how we use the Ola River, the tribe, the Fish and Wildlife Service, the city, and ensure that the state and the federal government does not come in and put in place low flow restrictions where the Skagit or the Dungeness or Morris Creek, when they hit a low flow point, it triggers automatic water restrictions. We want to be able to guide our own destiny, and by acting responsibly, ramping up drought stages over time, changing habits, that I think we will be able to maintain and continue to drive our own destiny for the river. So with that, I propose that that we move forward with stage three with the restrictions that are outlined in the ordinance and, again, outlined in the council memo. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Questions?
Oh, I just want to say thank you. I appreciate this. I did have a question, Mr. Bell. I mean, but you addressed it with the side of the street. I'm not going to get that. And just there's a tiny little typo on number four, on sprinkling and irrigation. That allows water rather than which allows water. So.
Mr. Mayor, I move to declare a stage three water shortage and authorize public works and the building department to implement and also restrictions on the use of water as detailed in the water shortage response plan.
Is there a second?
Second.
Move to second. Any further discussion?
Mr. Fulton, just I want to be clear on the odd even, because I'll be asked about that. So we're saying if you have an address of 110, so are we going by calendar days? How are we?
Just calendar days. So,
so
if your address is 110, you go
then you do the even and the year, right? I just want to make sure that's very clear and we can let the public understand that. And then on those days, it would be when it's your odd or even day, it would be up until 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. on your odd even.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? I hear you. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you.
Okay,
Okay, we are at the Landfill Stabilization, Reassign Lab Testing Services. Not tasting, testing.
This is a no cost. Ultimately, when these two change orders are put together, it's no cost to the contractor, the city. We're simply shifting a work line item from the construction contractor to the project manager regarding testing services. So it's a zero net change, but due to it's over $200,000 for each, one positive, one negative, we need to bring it to council. The reason we're shifting these the testing lab services is the project manager already has testing services already on site, so it's more efficient and effective for them to do it vice the contractor. Second is they have protocols as a project manager for these testing services already set in place. And the third is we want to keep the contractor focused on construction and not having to get into the side issue of these testing services and put it where it probably should better be as a project manager who is doing the testing and quality control. So I'm requesting your approval to authorize city manager to shift the testing services line item from the construction contractor to the project manager.
Question and control.
You just mentioned that, okay, so it would be more efficient if it was done by Anchor. So does that mean that because they might be more efficient, it might be more cost effective as well? Or is they're just gonna go straight for the same number?
No, absolutely. So this is a budget line item, so if the testing services are more efficient, they cost less, so that line item is not fully spent. We're trying to also not only make it quicker and easier for the contractor, but less costly.
Okay, and would we, since Anchor is the one that's overseeing the construction project, will the city be overseeing Anchor then on this testing to make sure, because like I said, Anchor is the construction management, so as to overseeing how well the testing is being done, is that?
Correct. Anchor will do the testing of the contract. Anchor as the contract manager will be doing the testing of the contractor's work, and then the city staff will oversee the final reports and testing results and make decisions based on how those results come in.
Okay, great, thank you.
Craig, I was wondering, since Magnus is losing a $219,000 portion of a contract, are they mad? Can we just pull that from them with no repercussions?
They've already agreed to these changes. They're losing the funding, but then they're not expending any costs against it. So it's no
they're
loss
okay
for them. It's it's not a profit, not a loss, it's just even.
Okay.
I do make a motion to approve and authorize the city manager to sign the change order number 10 to the Port Angeles Landfill Stabilization Project SW02-12 with the Magnus Pacific Corporation in a total credit amount of $219,927.34, including applicable taxes and removing the lab testing services, and two, the amendment one to the 2014 landfill construction management professional services agreement SW02-12 with Anchor QEA LLC in the like amount of $219,927.34, including applicable taxes, adding lab testing services.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Can we second any further discussion? Not hearing any, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Right, next is the 18th Street Reconstruction Project TR-16-99.
Council, this is a project long in coming. I've been discussing this, working this since I arrived 2 years ago, and finally coming to fruition with all the funding falling in place. So we went out for bids for the 18th Street reconstruction, which is an overlay of 18th Street from approximately Pacific Field area to the entrance of the solid waste facility, plus a short section on L Street, or N Street. On top of that, included with the overlay is some repairs, as you've driven down there, some really bad ruts that we had to repair over time because this was coming forward. So we'll be digging out and repairing some subbase. Only one contractor bid on this project, which was expected, Lakeside. They did come in under budget, $1.3 million versus engineer estimate of $1.4 million. As you'll note, there is no apprentice utilization program in this contract, even though it's over $1 million, and that's because we are using to use federal funding, we must use federal specifications on this. When federal specifications do not include in this an apprentice program. We did talk to Lakeside, and though they did say apprentices could be included at a higher price, but the offset of that is they would likely, they use local personnel and their contractors, so they would probably have to pull apprentices from out of the area, and local workers would not be used. So they prefer to move forward as the contract's written and use local labor, which I think is the best way forward for the local community. So with that, I'm looking to recommend this award and authorize city manager to sign a contract for Lakeside for 1.39 paid 18th Street.
Craig, can you say that because we're using federal dollars that they won't allow us to insert a requirement for the apprentice program?
Yes, and that's we had some discussions with the state, with WSDOT. They agreed with that. And our ordinance, the way our ordinance is set up, it also states that we have to abide by the apprentice program. We'll need to abide by state and federal guidelines for any grants received from them.
So just one quick correction on Director Fulton. I think he meant volunteer field, not south field. That's,
that's right. That would be a long paving project. Thank you. Yeah.
And Craig, did I hear you correct in saying that if there would have been an apprentice program requirement allowed, which isn't because of the feds, but if it was involved, then it would actually be putting local people out of work in favor of bringing apprentices in from out of the area? Is that
it all depends on the type of work. In this case, Lakeside doesn't have any local apprentices. On different trades, electrical, mechanical, it would be different. There are lots of local apprentices. So each trade is quite a bit different on the ability to have apprentices locally.
I've obviously been kind of an opponent to the apprenticeship program as a whole, and I think that's part of the reason is that there's certainly times when you have a blanket policy, it's hurting local workers in a number of opportunities like that. So just something to be aware of when it's a review time period on that, to look at that aspect of it.
And I think I'd like to add that, you know, the thing is that this is a local company, so it's currently using local workers. And where if you have a company from somewhere else that has to come in and then use local apprentice or the apprenticeship role, they would more than likely hire the locals. So I think that is one of the issues, is that they're locals and they're already hiring the folks here. So if there's no more questions, but I will move to award and authorize the city manager to sign the contract for the 18th Street Reconstruction Project TR16-99. Lakeside Industries of Port Angeles, Washington, in the total amount of $1,303,893.55, including applicable taxes and minor modifications to the contract if necessary.
Second. Okay, as we move to second, any further discussion?
Thank you.
Not hearing any, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you.
Okay, council requests.
Thanks for getting that street in there. I appreciate it.
Okay, council reports. Chase?
No report tonight. Thank you.
I had an opportunity going with Terry, governor, to attend recently a it's a committee that was an offshoot of the revitalized Port Angeles.
PA CAN.
PA CAN.
Yeah, it's called PA CAN. And some of you have this felt. I'm urging you to do that if you can. Trying to deal with the horrific drug abuse and the toll it's taking on our community as well as individuals. I was very impressed with the group. I think what Terry was 21 or 22 at the last meeting. Very impressed. It's the same core group, as it were, the same methodology, I guess I'll say, revitalized Port Angeles. And if this group is anywhere near, it's off to a running start by revitalized Port Angeles with Leslie Robertson, who we recognized earlier this evening. This is going to be an impressive and hopefully a highly successful grassroots effort to. Because I wouldn't be overly dramatic as they take back their time. Also opening for interest, the American Cruise Lines will go for Connecticut with a small cruise ship. The American Spirit will begin again their fall, summer fall schedule, which will begin on Tuesday, August 17th, whatever it is, Tuesday, Wednesday. Through the remainder of August, the all of September, and all of October. And bookings remain strong, and we're going to try for the first week or two of November. I think Tom is going to have that.
Yes, I have a report that this coming Sunday, August 9th at 5 o'clock, is the first Super Cup soccer game between Port Angeles alumni and SWIM alumni, and we, Port Angeles intends to be the victor of the game. I have a challenge bet with Mayor Candace Pratt from SWIM. When they lose the game, I will take her to lunch, and she will proudly wear the green and white colors of Port Angeles. If there's some unfortunate reason where Port Angeles can't beat them, and I don't foresee that at all, I would wear the purple and gold SWIM and hang my head. So come Sunday and support Port Angeles, a Super Cup, very first.
That's where it went?
5 o'clock, and I think it's at the college.
Just a couple of things. One is that I've been actually hearing from the folks with fireworks, which I thought was almost pretty much all done, but apparently there's a rumor out there that the council has been encouraging folks to light fireworks at the beach, and I just wanted to make sure that you guys knew that this is a rumor, and that to let folks know that that's not the case. And the second thing is that the draft for the climate change report has come out for the Olympic Peninsula. It's actually quite good. Took a look at it. There's policy in there that we could start looking at adopting. I sent a copy to Fulton, and so I think we need to start slowly, digesting it. Right now, it's still in draft form. I'm hoping that the final one will come out in the next month or two, but it's. Yeah, but I was very impressed with the way it was done. There are some really good suggestions that could move us forward well. So.
I was going to say no report, but I'm on the climate change core team, and they are moving forward. So, other than that, no report.
Okay, I would just like to inform the council that
started out as a vacation coming up here in the next couple of weeks. I started in something a little more serious. My father-in-law is gravely ill, so I'll be back in Florida and until he gets through, hopefully he'll get through this period of time in his life. But I will miss probably the next two council weeks. And I'll be back in time for the public hearings and the budget information, all the things that get scheduled for fall and early winter. Okay, anybody else? If not, we are at City Manager Report.
You do have some reports in your packet, and I encourage you to go over those. If you have any questions, you can go over the progress tab. And with that, I have nothing else.
Okay, thank you. Is there a need for a second executive session?
No, there's not.
Okay, we'll go to public comment again. Please step onto the microphone, give your name, address, keep your remarks for 3 minutes, please.
So my name is Marilee Smith, and I actually fit in the P.O. Box 2498 in Fort Angeles. And I'm actually a little concerned about the skate park being Laconian first, and second, it actually doesn't do a lot for us as being a bike-friendly town. I've been a member of the League of American Wheelmen, which is now the League of American Bicyclists, since 1972. And their stance on this is Clallam County and Fort Angeles has been given a bronze level status. But to get a silver or gold status, we need to allow our BMXers to use our skate park. And there's no reason why they're not using it. All of the major associations, including, what's his name? I have it right here. I just can't read. The State Park Association of the United States of America says there's no reason to not let BMXers use it. They encourage it. Tony Hawk Foundation says there is no reason to not do it. All the studies have shown that it doesn't cause any damage. So I think it's kind of punitive, and it's what we're doing is we're giving favoritism over one group of children over another. And BMXers have just as much right to use it as anyone else. So I have letters. I've got the letter from Tony McLeod, Henry McLeod, from the League of American Bicyclists, and his stance on it. And then I have just some other information. So can I give it to you?
Give us a purpose.
I have copies for all of you. That's really okay, interesting. Corey, is this something that you can fill us in the future?
Sure.
Actually, one's for Corey. Yeah. Can we get one for Corey and then here's? If you have information, it's actually really good information. I got more.
Give us some background. Is there any additional comments from the public?
On any issue?
Any issue?
Any
issue?
Including fluoride.
Yes.
Dr. Birchkin at 1111 Columbia Street. So, two more points quickly. One is, I'm just going to read a couple of things. There are spurious correlations, and you can correlate the amount of cheese eaten in Japan to the number of crashes of people in the United States in Japanese cars. And what makes a really good study, as a healthcare professional, we have to dig through these things because people try to sell this stuff all the time with these spurious correlations. And you eliminate confounders. And confounders are those things that weren't considered in the study that skews the data. So that's because you're gonna see a lot of studies in the future and at this public hearing, and looking at and eliminating confounders and distilling that data down to something very, very narrow is really, really hard. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, we know chemically that fluoridated enamel does not dissolve in acid
as easy as calcified enamel. That's just chemistry. So that's the only two things I have right now, and we'll see at the public hearing.
All right, thank you. Anyone else? Public comment period.
I'm anxious to hear Sissy's comments to question to Corey. I have one or two that may be related.
Corey, do you want to respond first?
Sure. I wasn't around when the skate park was in the design process. I was here, but I wasn't in the design process. When that skate park was built, it was built for skateboarders to get skateboarders out of the downtown area. Because the argument was bikes can't be on the roads and be on trails and skateboards can't. And that was one of the big pushes. Our biggest concern is safety. When you have 12 bicycles in there, you got little kids in there trying to skateboard, you should see how high those bikes get, and they get very dangerous. And the other part of the safety is those bikes have pegs on them, they have handlebars, they have pedals. That starts chipping concrete away. And when that starts happening, then you have more safety issues with the people that are trying to use it for a skate park. And once you start that chipping, it's very difficult to keep in shape after that. So that's what we're trying to avoid. It was said early on during the process, there's an ordinance that there's no bicycles in there. So that is what we're trying to hear by. But that'll take any additional comments.
It's my understanding, and I guess partly the previous conversations you and I had, you alluded to the skate park we have in Harris and Brayton, was specifically designed to accommodate bicycles.
Correct. And we were even told by the design team at that time that it's not built for parks or for bikes. What I would encourage someone from the community is to put a committee together. If there is any need, by all means, I'd be more than welcome to entertain any ideas, thoughts, and assist in the process. Because obviously, with the amount of kids that are in there, there is a need.
Can I make another comment?
Yes.
No, close it. Sorry.
On this topic.
Doesn't matter.
Do the BMXers have a place to go right now that's adequate?
I don't know. Not a city facility.
Well, BMX there was something in Lincoln Park?
There is a private, I guess it's a private BMX track there.
Correct.
I would just note that the skate park has been extraordinarily popular. And it's been a real asset to the community. And what I would suggest we do is we work with the BMX community to design a facility that they can use. I can't imagine why we wouldn't want to have two such successful facilities. To me, if we're going to do parks and recreation, do things that people want. And if it's really popular, then let's try to figure out how to do it. It might take us a while to figure out how to get it into the budget, but I think it's worth our effort if it's highly popular and it would help both the skateboarders and the BMX people.
Mr. Mayor, I was on the original skateboard committee. And I contributed to it, and the city didn't pay for this. It was the citizens of Port Angeles who wanted this facility for our kids, and we raised funds for it. And so the city actually, it was the Rotary Club and the citizens and the skateboard kids' parents, and this is what the community did. They came together to create a park for the skaters, so they'd stay off the streets, they stay off Lincoln Street, they stay off downtown, so it's designed for the skateboard. We can do the same thing for the bikers, it just takes someone to head up that effort, and I hope someone will.
Okay, any other questions?
So I had a question on a different topic, if we're finished with discussing the questions. So also for Corey, this is in regards to Mr. Cook that has made a couple appearances, and I believe he's gone now, but he's spoken a couple times with regards to plaques at the Veterans Associate or at the Veterans Center, and concerned that we're not allowing a plaque to be put up there. And I just wanted to double check. My understanding, Corey, is that this topic has been going on for well over a year, and I believe it's been fully vetted by the Parks and Rec Department and the Parks Commission and the Veterans Association.
You're correct. The city doesn't have a say, really, in what goes on there. It's really the Parks Commission's decision. They are the overseers of Veterans Parks and the plaques per council direction. What the Parks and Recreation Commission did is use the Veterans Association as kind of a subcommittee to get their advice on certain topics. Doesn't mean that they have to go with the vets' decision. They can make their own decision. Mr. Cook came to the Parks Commission one time with a idea of having a plaque for Vietnam draftees. They came back the second time with just draftees, and both times it was rejected unanimously by the Parks Commission, with recommendation both times from the Veterans Association.
Okay, thank you. Because he got a pretty good round of applause from the audience, and I can appreciate that because I believe our audience fully supports our veterans. And we've got a few veterans on the council, and I think there's a humongous amount of support for the veterans under the right circumstances that are not divisive. And so I'm glad to see that it's been vetted, it's been looked at continually.
Parks Commission stance was that all veterans and not just single out draftees. And we had a couple military veterans on our Parks Commission said, getting your honorable discharge was all that they needed, and not have to worry about whether they were drafted or not.
Thank you.
I'd like to add just a little bit on that, because I did spend quite a bit of time discussing that issue. And one thing that did come out was that because of different generations, we all see the military a little bit differently. Where I see, where I thought most of the folks were draftees versus most of the folks being volunteers. So historically, what I think would be interesting in the park is a history of when the dress started and when it was taken away. What's voluntary? Just for me, I know that it was something that I didn't realize how right now a young person who's 20 gets to register but it's not a forced draftee versus the folks that used to be in the, you would hope that you didn't get the lottery, and you were looking at anxious at the lottery. Anyway, so just as to the draft issue, I found it interesting. I know that it was divisive, and I thought, well, if you have draftees and volunteers, you've covered everybody. But again, I will leave it to the press for it. I just thought that it was something that hadn't been addressed, but it would be, I think, as a historical perspective, to show when it was on, when it was required, when it was not required. I just thought that would be interesting.
Well, we would have to go through the same process again, going to the Parks Commission and the VA. I will say that I believe I sent you guys an email to City Manager McKean, who I believe forwarded to you, that had a lot of the letters from the Veterans Association. I think there were six different entities that submitted letters, and so that's good reading material for reasons why they didn't come.
Yeah, no, I agree, and I've been talking to a lot of the vets, and I know that they don't want a plaque just for the draftees.
I think another reason for that, too, is that there's even another category, and I fall into that myself, where I had a very low draft number. I would have been drafted, but I wanted to be in the Air Force, not the Army. So I enlisted. But it was in part because I was going to get sucked in anyway. So at least I got into the branch that I wanted to go into. And so it's a hybrid, and that was a lot of people in my time frame. So, we might need a plaque, too, if we were going to be looking at those arguments. And that's one of the reasons I think the Veterans Association themselves doesn't favor going in this direction.
See, but I find that interesting that a 20-year-old wouldn't know anything of that, because that's not their generation. Mm-hmm. So, we all lived at, we have different knowledge of all those.
Education part would be great.
Yeah, I think an educational fact interesting just because of that.
Okay. Is that it? Thank you all for coming. We are adjourned.